Welcome to Questions for Christians. My name is Bernie Dehler, and I'm an atheist. And in the show, I talk to various Christians. Today, my guest is Jeff Zweerink, and I'll give him an introduction in a little bit. But like I said, this show is all about having a friendly dialogue between a Christian and an atheist for a lot of our viewers, so you can understand what you believe and maybe help solve some of those questions that you've had. For myself, just to give a little bit of an overview, and then I'll let Jeff give an overview for his background. I'm 54 years old, and I left the Christian faith about 7 years ago. I was raised a Roman Catholic as a child, and after college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian. I graduated from college in 1984, and I left the faith in 2009. And just so I remember why I left the faith, I wrote a little booklet. You can get it at Amazon.com. It's called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology. And I explain in there about how by learning more science, I thought I had to leave the faith behind because I think naturalism and atheism make better sense of the world, an atheistic worldview, primarily because of evolution, which seems to me to destroy the heart of the gospel. And then also, I think neurology shows that there's no such thing as a supernatural soul or no reason to believe in one. And if there's no soul, then there's nothing to resurrect. And that, of course, will crater the entire gospel story. And then on top of that, there's all kinds of philosophical issues like the problem of evil, which is made many times worse when you accept evolution, that humans evolved from other animals. Just to give a short description of my shirt, I'm wearing this shirt. It's a picture of Darwin made out of a bunch of animals. And so it shows about how there's, you know, the Christians have a creation story about how God did things by miracles. And Darwin gives another alternate story about how the species evolved and how they came about through common descent. So I'm bringing this as a reminder just about my worldview and how it explains creation. So now I'd like to introduce my guest, Jeff Zweerink. Jeff, feel free to take a few minutes. You can talk about your background, why you believe what you do, and what kind of books you have written or what kind of debates you have done, all that kind of stuff.
Okay, yeah, as you said, my name is Jeff Zweerink. I'm an astrophysicist. I've just had a fascination with how creation works and at all sorts of different levels from as young as I can remember, and just had a scientific interest in just trying to figure out how things work and why they work. I grew up in a home that was Christian, and my parents actively taught me about the Christian faith, and I personally trusted Christ as my Savior when I was in the fifth grade during an Awana program. And over the course of the next 10, 15 years or so, as I was going through high school and college, just began to really grow in my Christian faith, studying the Bible to see what it had to say. I went on a summer mission trip when I was just after my senior year of high school that really developed in me the disciplines of learning more what Christianity had to say. And as I went away to college, kind of these areas of my Christian faith and my scientific studies really kind of, I wouldn't say they clashed, but they did kind of, that's where I started to register some conflict, if you will. Yeah, I'd been taught that the earth was only 6,000 years old and that's what the Bible said. Scientific data said it was much older. And so I just began this process of asking the question, does what we find through our scientific studies affirm, deny, or contradict what we find as we study the scriptures? And I can say there's a number of issues that I have personally kind of looked into fairly deeply. I have found that any conflict is often a result of things being overstated in one area or the other, either what the Bible has to say or what the confidence of the scientific data is. And so I have found in my studies of creation that there's, I think that Christianity is a very rational way to view the world, and in my estimation, it makes the best sense of the data that we have when we look at how the universe works, how reliably it works, and how we can go about understanding it. And so I work for an organization called Reasons to Believe. One of the places where this has played out, where I've wrestled, was with the idea of the multiverse. When I first heard of the multiverse, it seemed like a threat to my Christian faith, and so I wrote a booklet that kind of chronicles my journey of looking and trying to understand the multiverse and seeing that it really does fit within Christian thought very well. And so one of my goals is just to help Christians see that science is an enemy of the, is not an enemy of the Christian faith.
Okay, so you basically work part-time at Reasons to Believe Ministry as an apologist, and you also work part-time as a scientific researcher, right?
That's correct. I actually work full-time at Reasons to Believe, but part of my job there allows me to maintain a position that I had at UCLA as a research scholar, as a research physicist over there, and currently I'm working on a balloon experiment trying to figure out what the dark matter is. So.
Okay, and can you remind us again, what was the field that you have your PhD in and the school you went to?
My PhD is in high-energy astrophysics, specifically working on gamma ray or high-energy gamma rays, and I did my undergraduate and graduate work at Iowa State University in Ames, Iowa. Graduated in 91 with my bachelor's and in 97 with my PhD.
Okay, way over my head. hey, I appreciate that you got a PhD. That's pretty impressive. So, and you know, from science and from a real college, unlike some of my guests we've talked about, they have.
If you want to understand how creation works, you need to go in and study it pretty deeply. And so, I've enjoyed learning what I can about creation. So.
And just real briefly, I don't want to go into long depth in this, but I think that we have a common ground that we both believe that science can help us determine whether God exists or not. Would you agree with that? And I mean, we just have different conclusions, but we both agree that science can give us very strong reasons for our belief.
I do think science has a capacity not to prove one way or the other, but it certainly has a lot of data that weighs in on the issue. Yeah.
Okay. Because there are some apologists who really, they have totally different arguments and they don't like to talk about science or anything.
I think that is the case. And, you know, without looking at any specific one, it might be hard to understand why that is. But I think that the scientific data, yeah, there's things where the Bible talks about how this world behaves that science can also investigate. And if those don't correspond, then I think that's definitely has impact on whether God exists or not.
So. Okay, and that's going to be one of our major topics, so we'll go into that a lot more later. So we'll go into question number one, and basically we have five questions or things to talk about here, and the first four you suggested, and so I suggested the fifth one. I'll just do a quick overview here. The first one is, you're saying that science shows that the universe had a beginning, and then we're going to talk about that. You're going to say, the second one is that the universe, that science is looking like it shows that the universe was designed for life. The third one is that the Christian worldview gives a good reason for the foundation of science and doing science. The fourth one is you are saying that it looks like there's a universal teleology, which is evident even to children. And the fifth one is the one that I'm recommending is a lot of people say there's a science versus religion conflict. And I would say maybe I think a better description is magical thinking versus scientific thinking. So those are our five topics. Any quick comments on those topics?
No, I'm looking forward to our discussion.
Okay, so we'll start the first topic. It's you're saying that science shows that the universe had a beginning. So I'll give you a minute to set up the discussion of how you would like to take it. And so basically we want to highlight points of agreement and also disagreement, and we can talk about where we disagree and why.
Right. Yeah, I think when I look at the issue of a beginning, this seems to be scientifically something that has played out over the last 100 or so years since the advent of Einstein's development of the theory of general relativity, that before that it just didn't seem to be a question. But in general relativity, you've got this dynamic nature to space and time, and there have been just a number of key discoveries throughout the last 100 years that even though scientists have proposed and continue to propose models that don't have a beginning, it seems like the data keeps driving us back to the idea that the universe began to exist. And when I, again, look at what Scripture has to say, that's one of those doctrines that seems to play pretty prominently. You've got this doctrine of creation ex nihilo, that God transcends the physical universe and brings the universe into existence. And so I find this corroboration between what we find scientifically and important biblical doctrines. And I think that's pointing to the idea that God is the author of both of those.
Okay, yeah. I think it was J.P. Moreland who did a presentation on this, and I did a little counter-presentation to it once. But he went into great detail about how we know there was a beginning to the universe. And so I would like to say that, you know, I think we have common ground on that. I believe there is also a beginning. We can say the Big Bang was the beginning of time and space, and maybe there's a multiverse or something out there that gave birth to our universe. So can we go forward from that point? I mean, let's say we have a common, can we say we have a common agreement there that there's a time, a beginning for the universe?
Yeah, I think that does. I mean, we could spend a lot of time talking about some of the things why scientists say there might not be a beginning, but I think it sounds like we have a common ground there.
Well, why would a scientist say there's not a beginning?
Well, the big reason is that in order to answer the question of whether there's a beginning or not, we need a quantum theory of gravity, and we just don't have that theory yet. And so there is this little bit of uncertainty as to whether the universe genuinely has a beginning or not. But you know, I don't think we're going to have the answer to that for another couple of decades. So.
Well, I think I've also heard, too, that, you know, I don't know, so this is your field of work, so you would probably know more about this as far as rumors and stuff, but from what I heard, according to the Big Bang Theory, some people say that that could have been the beginning of time and space, but some say they don't know. It may not have been the beginning of time and space. Basically, the correct answer is we don't know.
Yeah, and that's often, or at least the objection or the response I've heard from those who want to argue that quantum gravity will get around a beginning, or at least it says that we just don't know. You look at the Christian apologist who's going to argue for a beginning, they'll look at something like the space-time theorems of general relativity. The problem with those is that, or the weakness in those is that in order for that to establish that there's a beginning, general relativity has to be true, and precisely the moment we expect it to break down is right at the beginning. And so there's a little bit of uncertainty there. But, the response, just to echo what you're saying, is that some people say, well, we don't know whether there's a beginning, so let's not overstate what we know at this point.
Yeah, actually, so, the way I understand it, too, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but, the reason why they say there's probably a Big Bang is because we see everything going away from each other, and it's actually speeding up. All the planets, all the galaxies, all the galaxies are, generally speaking, going away from each other. I mean, sometimes they come together, like the Milky Way is on a collision course with Andromeda Galaxy, I guess. But most of the universes are all, I mean, most of the galaxies are all spreading out. And so they say, well, if you play that tape backwards, it all comes to a certain point. And that's according to Einstein's theory of relativity or general relativity. But when you start shrinking it down and you get to the quantum mechanics, that's where Einstein general theory of relativity no longer comes into play. And now we have quantum mechanics and there's all these unknowns in quantum mechanics. Is that right?
Well, it's not so much just that there's unknown, it's that you need to have a quantum theory of gravity, and we don't know what that looks like. But at least a couple of the ideas that we have for that might be a quantum theory of gravity indicate that there might be a minimum size. And so instead of collapsing down to a point or a singularity, it might be that you end up kind of the universe goes through this smallest phase, maybe from a prior contracting phase. And so, there's a whole lot of, it's not a settled issue. That's my only point.
But, right.
But I do think that there's, the idea that the universe began to exist is a credible idea, although it's not settled by any stretch.
Well, another interesting thing there that I think people don't realize is, tell me if I'm wrong or not, but scientists don't even really know what gravity is. Like maybe there's a graviton or something. I think that's what you're talking about. Talking about a quantum level of gravity that we don't really even understand what gravity is, right?
I think there's some real truth to that. I mean, at least when you've got Einstein's theory of relativity, there is at least a physical mechanism for how gravity works because you're warping the fabric of space and time. But again, that's fundamentally a classical theory. It's not a quantum theory. And so it's unknown what that true quantum nature of gravity is. And because gravity is such a weak force, it's really difficult to do the experiments on the small scales that allow us to figure out what sort of parameters constrain it.
Yeah, so I mean, basically we know it's there. We can see the time-space warping and all that. We can see the effects of it, but exactly how does it do it? Is there a graviton or whatever? We have no idea in science how that actually happens.
Right. But in, I mean, even in the context of all that, I think it's important to note that general relativity is a spectacularly successful theory in describing the dynamics of the universe, not the least of which is this prediction of gravitational waves that were detected a few months ago. So it really is a phenomenally successful theory, but there is just this question of how does it get modified when you get down onto the smallest scales, like would happen at the beginning of the universe.
Okay, so I believe that, you know, the universe could have had a beginning. Maybe it was birthed by something else, like a multiverse, and you know, energy could be eternal. So what's wrong with that, or why do you think that there must be a God to answer it? And doesn't, if you say God started it, isn't that just a, like what they say, a mystery wrapped in an enigma, since we don't know what God is? It just kind of, when you say God did it, it's like, that's like saying nothing, because it doesn't explain anything. It's just saying magic, kind of.
Well, no, there's a place where I agree with what you said and a place where I disagree. And so I'll hit the place where I disagree is that, one, the idea of a multiverse, at least when you're talking inflationary type multiverses, those still seem to have a beginning. So the Big Bang, you know, the beginning of our universe is no longer the beginning, but even the multiverse seems to have a beginning. And so there's a little bit of, even positing the multiverse doesn't get you to something eternal. But I agree very much with your point that what you're saying is that because our universe exists, or even because there's a Big Bang, that there needs to be something eternal. And so in my assessment, the real question is, what is the nature of that eternal being or substance, if you will? You know, you could say that it's energy, but what I would argue is that in order for that, whatever that eternal self-existent stuff is, it has to be eternal. It has to be self-existent. It's got to have the capacity to bring universes into existence. And if consciousness is something that, in order to explain consciousness, I think you can make an argument that it also has to be conscious. And so, you know,
to be conscious?
Well, you do run into this problem, or this, if you're going to say energy is eternal and that's what explains our universe, that thing has to explain everything about our universe. And so there's the question of if consciousness is just purely a, or that raises the question of, is consciousness just purely a physical phenomena, or is it something beyond just physical? And
that's a different question. What is consciousness? I mean, the question though is, why does the beginner of everything have to have a consciousness?
Well, because if we have consciousness, whatever caused us had to be able, or it has to be an adequate cause of that.
Yeah, but why does it have to be conscious?
Because we're conscious. What if we're conscious and whatever it is that produced this isn't, then in some sense,
but still, I mean, if we had feathers, you wouldn't have to say the creator had feathers, because we have feathers. So we have consciousness, but why do we have to come from consciousness?
Well, but there is a fundamental distinction there, in that feathers are a way to rearrange the matter. And so if we're just talking about rearranging matter, that works. But if consciousness isn't just rearranging the matter, then you end up with this odd thing that we can think about the universe, but the universe can't think about us. And so we're greater than the universe in that capacity, or greater than the energy that caused the universe.
I don't know if it's greater. I mean, I mean, that's, why is it, I don't think it's greater. I mean, why couldn't consciousness just be a property or attribute of things that evolved? That, you know, if there's no God, all these different things happen, like, you know, there's all kinds of different levels of consciousness from different animals. The more complex brain, the more consciousness. So, you know, if humans never evolved and there were just ants, this is a difficult question to give you, because I know you don't accept evolution. So maybe we're showing a huge difference in understanding there.
Well, I guess to me the central question, and you know, independent of what goes on in the rest of the animal kingdom, I do agree that there's different levels of awareness of the environment by different animals, and so ants don't have nearly the perception of the world that, say, a dog would. But to me, the key distinction is that as humans, we can think about how the world operates, but the world doesn't think about how we operate, that there's a fundamental distinction there, that all things considered equal, that a God better motivates why we're conscious than a non-conscious, self-existent reality.
Okay, I don't see how it follows. But we can move on to the next topic. Do you want to say anything in closing? Like, they give you last word there. If you want to say anything on closing on that.
Yeah, I guess I would. You know, what I will find, or I'll reiterate this with each of these. I don't think any of these are slam dunk. Oh, this is the only way to look at this is that God exists. But I do think, given all of this, that the best explanation for all of these is kind of a cumulative case. The best explanation is God, and so that doesn't preclude that there may be some other mechanism for explaining this from a different worldview.
Okay, and I guess one thing I like to say, sometimes, you know, Christians do say we don't have a, you know, a knockdown argument, but we do have a cumulative case. We have this argument, this argument, this argument, this argument. And in my opinion, all the arguments are invalid. They're like logical fallacies of one sort or another. So just because you have a whole bunch doesn't mean your whole argument's any better. I mean, I think it's a cumulative case of logical fallacies personally. So
can you tell me where's the logical fallacy, and if there's a beginner, or if there's a beginning, then that points to a beginner or a self-existent reality that causes the universe?
Well,
the
biggest thing on the top of my mind is that you say, for example, consciousness needs to be explained, and you explain that by a consciousness that just always existed. And basically, this is a God. It's a God without a brain too, because biologically we have brains and our minds come from our brains, and yet God does not have a brain because he's not physical, but he's got a mind. So he's got a brainless mind because there's no brain, but everything we know about minds only come from brains, and so that's a huge gap. I mean, why can God do that? Well, there's special pleading. Oh, only God can do this. You know, it's only a case for God.
Well, I mean, again, I guess I would look at that from a worldview of, you say, okay, if God exists, then what are the attributes of God as he's revealed them to us? And part of how he's revealed is that he has the capacity to bring physical existence, or the physical realm into existence. And so I don't see why that's a contradiction, given the character of God, that he has the capacity and the power to do to create beyond space and time, matter and energy. Why is it a contradiction to say that he can create a certain type of consciousness that doesn't exceed his?
Okay, so ready to go on to the next one?
Sure.
Okay, so on this one here, you said, so when you look at the evidence of the world, when you look at science, it looks like our universe was designed for life. So I'll give you a minute to lay that case out.
Yeah, I think when you look at, one, what scientists have said, and you know, in my discipline of looking at kind of the physics of how the world works, that there's a number of places that if you have small changes in the strength of the electromagnetic force, or the dimensions of space-time, or how quickly things decay, or the speed of light, if you change any of those, you end up with it seems like you would end up with a universe that is incapable of hosting life, and you know, just with kind of some fairly minimal specifications for a universe that can host life, is that you have to have, you know, something like carbon and something like water that allows the complex biochemistry that life requires. And so a lot of those attributes of our universe, the existence of water, the existence of carbon, the existence of oxygen and hydrogen, that if you tweak the laws of physics very slightly, you end up with a universe that doesn't have those things and therefore would be devoid of life. And so it looks like...
Devoid of life,
life
as we... That would be devoid of life as we know it, but there may be a different form of life?
Well, I mean, there is that possibility, but again, I think I would add a little bit more of a sophistication to it, is that there's this assumption that life can happen, or that life has this great range of parameters that it could exist under. And at least if we're talking about physical life, you've got to have some sort of element that allows the complexity for life to exist. And of all the different elements we know, carbon is the only one that even comes close to that. And you've got to have some sort of medium that allows that chemistry to take place. And again, water, it's not just, well, we could look at other different things. In all the ways that life requires, water is one of the best, if not the best, substances for doing that across this wide suite of properties. And so I think if you're going to say that, well, life as we know it, then in some sense the burden of proof lies a little bit on the person making that argument to show how life could exist otherwise. And
you know,
I haven't seen a good argument for that.
Well, one thing on that along those lines, one time years ago I saw this debate that was on a video, and there was this panel of like NASA scientists, and they're talking about, you know, exploring for life in other planets, and they're saying the question is, what if there's a different kind of life? How would you look for it? And I was thinking, how would you look for something we have no idea about? But I was surprised that they actually came up with some criteria, and you know, like, for example, there may be exchanges, you know, there's input and output, like, you know, input is you breathe nitrogen or whatever, and then you take an oxygen and exhale nitrogen or something. You know, there's different signatures they could look for. And I thought it was kind of brilliant because they were going beyond carbon-based life to look at other kinds of ways to detect different kinds of life. But I have two main questions for you on this. One is, I was looking at Vic Stenger. He wrote God, the Failed Hypothesis, something like that book. I can't remember the exact name of it. And he's also an astrophysicist but an atheist. And it seems like on the topic, on the surface, though, there's an obvious conflict, especially for somebody as yourself that rejects evolution, that humans descended from other animals and all that. And that is, on the one hand, you argue that the universe is fine-tuned to create life, I guess. But on the other hand, you say that evolution, things cannot naturally evolve, and so God has to intervene and make creatures by a miracle. So on the one hand, you're saying God is doing things by miracle because it can't happen. On the other hand, you're saying everything is tuned for life.
I think I would agree. I think often how this argument is put forth is it has that kind of talking out of both sides of your mouth problem to it. And I think the way I would articulate it is that if changes were made to the laws of physics, the material that life requires wouldn't even exist. And so we see evidence of fine-tuning in producing the materials that life requires. Now, there's a secondary question, which I think is harder to get strong data one way or the other, is what are the conditions that life requires in our universe? Does it require this kind of planet? Might it have, you know, might there be life in the subsurface of Europa? And I personally think the search for life beyond planet Earth is just a great scientific question. I think it's also a neat theological question. But so what I would say is that just because the universe can produce many of the, or is tuned to produce all of the elements that life requires, that isn't necessarily sufficient to produce the complexity of life that we see here on Earth.
So
God was tuning the original, I don't see why he might not be involved at places in the other.
So real briefly, so on biological evolution, you don't think that could happen naturally, but on what you might say is cosmological evolution, a lot of people haven't heard this term, but cosmological evolution, which could explain from the Big Bang, basically the evolution of planets, how planets are formed. Planets are formed from heavier elements, which were made from the explosion of supernova, mm-hmm. You know, stars that blew up. So you fully accept cosmic evolution as far as creating all the elements over billions of years, but not biological evolution. Is that right?
Well, I mean, I would say this again. I the idea of do I accept or reject biological evolution is I just don't think there's the nuance in that question, because I think there, you know, the biological evolution does have a capacity to produce new or to generate changes in things.
No, but as far as humans, I mean, just for biological evolution, I'll say, for example, humans evolving from other animals versus humans made from scratch.
I would say there's a problem. The in my assessment, the biggest thing about humans that requires God's intervention is our consciousness and our ability to think beyond just the physical world. And so I don't think any amount of biological evolution is going to produce that, because I don't just think rearranging the matter or rearranging how it all works is going to produce humanity and the consciousness that humanity has.
Right, but as far as cosmic evolution, you are fully on board with that all the elements basically came through billions of years of activity? Stars forming and blowing up.
That the universe started with hydrogen and helium, and stars formed all the heavier elements, and
right.
Supernova explosions. And I think that's an integral part of the process that we can understand. And I also think, but I would also argue that I think in terms of fashioning a planet where everything comes together for life, not that it's unexplainable, but that it looks like it's designed.
Do you think all the carbon in the world was made from the furnace of stars?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, there's no miracle. There's no, like, God had to go, boom, there's carbon. It was just, it went through a process of transformation from...
And again, I don't know how most Christians would argue, but as I've studied, that the God's work in creation isn't just simply the places where the laws of physics are not adequate, that God... The reason why things behave so reliably is how God is sustaining creation. And so the fact that he uses the way he sustains creation to bring about the effects that he wants is just, that's very open and ripe for scientific discovery. And sometimes it's even through extraordinary means that are odd, but also explainable via the laws of physics. But that doesn't preclude that he may operate outside the laws of physics at times. But I think those kinds of miracles are fairly rare.
Okay. Ready to go on to the next topic?
Sure.
Okay, so on this one you're saying you believe that the Christian worldview gives a better foundation for science.
Right.
I'll let you lay that case out real briefly.
Yeah, and this isn't to say that you have to be a Christian to practice science, or that other worldviews didn't, there weren't people in other worldviews that had some scientific progress was made. But I think it's a fairly rigor, or you can make a fairly strong case that the scientific enterprise was birthed in a Judeo-Christian worldview, because in order to do science, there's a, you know, different philosophical requirements that you got to have laws of nature uniform throughout the universe, that the universe is distinct and objective reality that can be studied, that it's regular and orderly, that the universe is intelligible, that it's not divine, so it's not to be worshipped. You know, it's good to study that humans have the ability to discover the universe's intelligibility, that the intellectual virtues essential to science of testing and falsifiability and integrity, that all of these things. To do science, you have to act as though these things are true, and the worldview that anchors all of those and says that they all ought to be true is the Christian worldview.
Well, I mean, to me, this, I don't know, I don't understand how you can say that, because for me, the reason why I like science is because I believe that it has proven itself. In other words, a good theory can make predictions, and the predictions come true, and that just shows the power. If somebody doesn't use science and they use something else, like, let's say, for example, you go to war and somebody uses science, they can create a better weapon than somebody who wants to cast spells, for example. The person casting spells is going to lose that real quick. So
right.
The thing I like about science is that it proves itself. Proof is in the pudding kind of thing. So you said that the Christian worldview expects nature to be uniform, regular, orderly, but that seems to contradict everything because, for example, you don't believe in biological evolution, that humans evolved from other animals. You believe that humans were just created, boom, from scratch, and also certain animals like whales, boom, giraffes, boom, tigers, boom. So that would just blow apart all deductive, inductive logic, abductive. I mean, when you try to explain how that came, it's basically whenever you say a miracle, that means you totally threw out the window. You threw out uniformity. You threw out regularity. You threw out your orderliness. You threw all that stuff out the window.
Well, I would disagree. And again, I want to iterate here. I agree very much that science has a great capacity and it's demonstrated its effectiveness. But again, when I'm looking at what worldview anchors all of the things that make science so successful, that it's the Christian worldview that argues that the world is worthy of study, that it's not divine, that we should be worshipped, because if it should be worshipped, you don't study it. That it's intelligible, because it flows out of how reliably God sustains creation. It's orderly and reliable and intelligible because of that. That humanity has the capacity to understand it because we're made in God's image and can see what he's done and understand that. And so I'm not saying that I agree that science is incredibly successful, but when you look throughout history, it seems like the worldview that allowed science to blossom and flourish is arguably the Christian, or you know, the Judeo-Christian Western society where that happened.
But if you're going to believe that God made humans from scratch, don't you agree that you have to throw out the uniformity, the regularity, and the orderliness of all of nature, because you're saying nature could not have done that through regular processes? It took a miracle. There's no way to figure out scientifically how it happened because it never happened.
Well, I two things I would say. One is that God doing something doesn't mean that it operates outside the laws of physics. And again, I would argue that, as I understand Christian theology, that creation, if God were to withdraw his hand, creation would just simply cease to exist. And so the fact that it operates so reliably is a reflection of how consistently and reliably God sustains creation. And so that's what provides the foundation of why we can go look and see, oh, this thing that happened today, given the same circumstance, is going to happen identically tomorrow.
But when it comes to the creation of humans, you're saying that nature is not uniform. It's not regular. It's not orderly. It's very disjunctive to have a miracle. It means it cannot happen naturally, you're saying.
I agree that there are times where God steps in and does things that cannot be explained via the laws of physics. But that doesn't mean that we have to throw science out the window, and particularly if science, or if looking at creation was all we had to do, that I agree that would be very difficult.
Well, let me put it this way: can you figure out how humans came to be through science?
Aspects, yeah. I don't think completely, because I don't think consciousness and what I would consider being made in God's image is something that's going to be explainable just simply via the laws of physics.
Well, it seems like if you're going to use uniformity, regularity, and orderliness to try to explain everything, like the origin of humans, then, I mean, if you're looking at that, a miracle is not going to be one of those things, because a miracle is not orderly, regular, or uniform. That's the opposite of a miracle, basically.
No, I would agree. But again, I would say if creation was all we had to look at, that would be a problem. But I also... God's revealed himself through creation that we can study via science, but he's also revealed himself through scriptures. And it's when I look at integrating both of those, I would also recognize, okay, there's something about humanity that's not going to be completely explainable via science, although science can give us a great amount or has great insight into a lot of aspects of humanity. So it's I don't see why, just because there are occasional miracles, and I would argue that we see those as revealed through scripture, why I have to throw out science just because there might be an occasional miracle, especially if I can identify where that miracle would have occurred.
Yeah, but I mean, it's a lot more just an occasional. I mean, you're talking about every single major species or kind or whatever was made from scratch. For example, tigers have no biological connection with giraffes and sharks and humans and pine trees, whereas a naturalist would say these are all related through DNA. You know, even the plants and the animals are all related through DNA.
But I've never said that God just poofed them into existence. I do think God has used both process and direct intervention. So I think at least as I've studied Christianity, Christian theology, the idea that the capacity of animals to adapt to environment, that could have some efficacy of producing new creatures, that God might then go and change into something a little different, particularly the relational capacity of animals. And so I don't see those as being contradictory to one another.
Well, I thought you believed that humans kind of basically poofed into existence. So you're saying you think more like God maybe used evolution and it was God guided then? I'm not sure exactly what your view is. Can you be real brief about how you think God made humans?
I think in terms of how the physical bodies are made, I don't have a good answer. I don't think scripture is that definitive as to whether this was just something that, you know, the body was something completely new. But I do think the consciousness, the image of God, that is biblically what distinguishes humanity from all the rest of the animals, that's something that is introduced by God that doesn't have a physical explanation. So I think it's probably a combination of where we can get a physical or maybe some physical mechanism as well as God intervening to bring about human consciousness.
Okay, ready for the next topic?
Sure.
Okay. This one, I'll cut it down a little bit because see if we can catch up on time.
Okay.
So you're saying that there's a universal teleology even with small children, so I'll let you lay that case out real briefly.
Yeah, this is just something, as I've read various journal articles, that kind of universal across humanity is this idea that there's something beyond just the physical, that there's a God who's doing something, or there's a spiritual aspect out there. And to me, that is a difficult thing to understand if the physical creation is all there is. It seems to make more sense in a worldview where the physical is very important, but there's also a spiritual dimension that transcends the universe. And the fact that it's kind of universal across humanity seems to say that it's something inherent to humanity, that we have this capacity to think beyond the physical, which is unusual if we're just physical creatures.
Well, let me try to relay. I think this is Michael Shermer that said this. You may have heard this example, but you know, he said, for example, let's say you're an ancient human in the African forest and you see some leaves moving. So it's kind of normal to, or natural to say, like, well, there might be a lion in there. It's better to have a false negative, because if you think there might be a lion in there, then you go run off and save yourself. If you don't, you might be lunch. And so,
right.
And so, you know, whenever something happens, if you're sleeping at night and you're always wondering about being attacked at night, if you hear a strange sound, your first thought might be there's an intruder. And if you don't see anything, then maybe the next step is thinking, well, maybe there's invisible creatures. And then especially when you have dreams, you know, sometimes people dream about deceased people, so they think that might be evidence for, you know, ghosts. So, I mean, maybe there's good explanations for ghosts for that reason. And then God is basically just, you know, the ultimate ghost. They call him, the Holy Spirit's called the Holy Ghost. It's just, you know, an immaterial mind.
Yeah, I guess what my contention is that I agree that being able to see whether there's an animal that's attacking and being aware that there's a utility to that, but it doesn't follow, as I see it, that that you begin thinking about things that are non-physical, because if the physical is all there is, why are we having thoughts about stuff that doesn't actually exist? That just doesn't seem to make sense to me. And that seems to be something that is being borrowed from a Christian worldview where the physical is not all there is. It makes more sense for us to be thinking about things beyond the physical in a Christian worldview than it does in a worldview where the physical is all that exists.
Why is it such a big deal to think about things that don't exist? For example, you know, there's very elaborate stories about, you know, the Harry Potter series and Star Wars sagas, and some people know the stuff inside and out. It's like these characters are alive in their head, but it's all fiction.
I agree, but again, all of that's going on in the context of humanity. And I would argue that humanity has that capacity to think beyond the physical because we're made in God's image. It's not clear to me why in a world where the physical is all there is.
Say that again, why what?
Sort of things start thinking about stuff that's not actually physical.
Can you say that last part again?
So in a world where the physical is all there is, which is, I'm assuming that's an accurate characterization of an atheist worldview.
I would prefer the word naturalist. Instead of materialist, say natural. Yeah, everything's natural.
Okay. So where the natural world is all there is, why is it that any organisms in that realm have the capacity to think about stuff that is beyond the natural world?
Because, I mean, we just have brains. Brains compute. We evolved brains because it's a survival thing. There's a very strong fight for survival. The person with the smarter brain is going to have a hand up.
Correct. But what's going on there in that argument, as I see it, is, you know, for the dog or the cat or the tiger or whatever to see things, there's a very physical reality of what they're, you know, there are cats and dogs and tigers and other things that are attacking. To go now and to say that there are these things that we can't see that are unphysical, that are outside the natural realm, that seems to be a change of categories there. And again, for humans, that makes perfect sense in a Christian worldview. It's not clear to me that that makes sense from a naturalist worldview.
Well, what about somebody who's, you know, in his room at night and they're a little bit scared because, let's say, they're kind of they're like a teenager and their parents are gone. They're all by themselves at night and they hear a sound. You know, and they check it out and it turns out it's nothing, but they actually were freaked out because they thought it was a burglar or a demon or something. So, you know, they thought there was something there and there wasn't. Maybe that's what God is. We think there's something there and there's not.
But why, I mean, and again, I would love to investigate this at some point in time to see, I don't think there's any evidence that dogs think of their past ancestors, or maybe there's ghosts out there, that seems to be a uniquely human phenomenon. And I agree that because we're made in God's image, we have that capacity. But what my question is if we're not, if there is no God and the physical world, the natural world is all there is, why are we having these thoughts about things that are completely unnatural or that are beyond the natural world? That I'm able to think about something that's beyond what actually exists.
Well, I mean, maybe it's just part of maturity. Like when you're a child, you could easily believe in Santa Claus and the Tooth Fairy, but when you get older, like at your age, it's impossible to believe in the Tooth Fairy, you know? And so maybe, like, you know, the Neanderthals, they were saying, who caused the lightning? We know, we see fire, we can maybe even start fire, so there's fire in the sky, obviously there must be a fire god, and who causes the earthquakes? Who causes the floods? You know, maybe it's just immaturity that you say it was magic and just an appeal to magic because they don't know the answers. And then we learn the answers in science. We learn about electricity. We learn about tectonic plates. Maybe it's just immature humans.
The only species we seem to have any evidence that has the capacity to think beyond the physical is humanity. And for in my worldview of a Christian, that makes sense because we're made in God's image. It's still not clear to me why, if the natural world is all there is, why would there be organisms that can think about things beyond the natural world?
Okay. Ready for the next topic?
Yes.
Okay, so this next one is, this was my undoing. My pick. It's, you know, a lot of times it's very well known in Christian atheist debates. There's this topic of science versus religion. And I think a better description is magical thinking versus scientific thinking. And the way to illustrate this, and I believe you're what they call an old earth creationist, which means as far as cosmology, you're totally in line with modern science on everything about cosmology. But when it comes to biology, you think modern science is wrong in teaching that humans, for example, evolved from other animals. So a step worse than that as far as accepting modern science, in my viewpoint, would be young earth creationists, which deny cosmological evolution and everything about cosmology. So you're a step up, I would say, from that. And then like the next step up from you, I think, would be evolutionary creationism, which says there's no conflict with science whatsoever because we believe everything about biology that modern science has to say. We believe everything about cosmology. So for example, for you as an old earth creationist, you think that nature cannot produce humans, for example. And so how are humans created? Well, usually, I mean, I thought it was like, you would say like, poof, there's humans. And poof, there's every kind of major species, whale. From one whale, maybe all these different kinds of whales evolved. From one kind of tiger, all these different cats, or one kind of cat, all these cats evolved. From one kind of dog, all these dogs evolved. But there's no biological link between all of these. That's how I thought traditionally the progressive, I thought you're like a progressive creationist where you believe that over time, God makes species at certain points in time from scratch by poof, basically. So that's what I think is magical thinking, because when you do that, you're saying basically just God did it by magic. How did he do it? He just said, let there be, and boom, there it is. So I'll let you give you some time to respond to that.
Well, I guess I would say, you know, one comment I would say is that while I think there's a lot of stuff in cosmology that I agree with, there are areas where I think there are some wrong ideas. One of the ideas is that where there's life or where there's water, there's going to be life on a planet. And so it's not this uniform acceptance of everything in cosmology and astronomy and this uniform rejection of everything in biology. But again, what I would say is that as I understand what Scripture is describing in Genesis 1, where it's talking about God's creative work, is that God creates the universe. There are certain animals that he creates, and specifically it's these relational animals, and then also creates humanity, and specifically being made in his image. And so I don't know that the physical stuff of the animals that are being created, that's part of God's original creation. And so the fact that he might use some sort of process to put the body together, I don't know that that's right, but it actually wouldn't bother me a whole lot to find out that that were right. And so what I am trying to do as a Christian is say, okay, God's revealed stuff about how he created and how he works through the Scripture, and God has revealed a lot about how he's created and how he's worked through creation, and I want to study both of those under the idea and an evidenced idea that I've looked at this in at least a few areas in depth, that where I've properly interpreted both the words of Scripture and the universe, that they're going to say the same thing.
I guess I'm kind of curious, why do you think the Bible is teaching anything whatsoever about science or creation? I mean, for example, you know, if you take the young earth creationists, they say, you know, God created everything in 6 days about 6,000 years ago. Mm-hmm. And you're saying, no, those 6 days in Genesis are not literally 6 days. They could be eons or time periods or whatever. And then basically you just interpret it as not as 6 24-hour days. But yet the Bible does teach us something about science. And then the next step up, the evolutionary creationists, they would say, of course the Bible didn't say anything about science. You don't go to the Bible for science. There's nothing about science whatsoever in the Bible. It's just to teach you theological things. You don't learn anything about biology, how humans were created, or anything from the Bible. So why do you think the Bible is actually trying to teach anything about science, about how humans were created or anything like that?
I would say because, as I've, there's a long-standing, well-developed discipline and tradition of how do we go about interpreting what the words of Scripture are. And, there's principles and rules that are that have been developed to help ensure that we have an accurate interpretation. Now, what I would say is, as we go and look at what the words of Scripture are and how and apply that proper interpretation method, where it says something very specific, then we ought to look for that. And so in the Genesis creation account, or just even throughout Genesis, these are written like they're historical accounts of things. And so in the same way, I would expect there to be a city of Jericho and a king named David and a person named Jesus who lived certain times ago. So I would expect there to be events in the distant past where humanity was created and where the land was, where continents formed and where the universe was created. And so I would, in going out and looking at the physical world, I would expect to see evidence for those things.
But I don't understand how you can say there's ways, there's rules of interpretation that you get from Christian history, because like I said, there's like three major camps. I mean, one camp is much more literal than you. They have their own seminaries and everything. And then there's another camp that's more figurative, and they don't believe the Bible says anything about science whatsoever. So how could you say, I mean, your worldview obviously is the correct worldview, but you think the other major camps are wrong, right? But the other camps think you're wrong.
No, that's fair. But I think that's the reality of humans trying to do anything. I find that same sort of confusion, if you will, in looking at science and what people say is science and what people say isn't science. And I do think there's a fairly strong consensus among a lot of scientists as to what's the proper way to do things. But I find people who say this is completely wrong one way or the other. And so I think that's just I don't think that's unique to studying the words of Scripture. We find that same sort of phenomena when we look at scientists studying creation as well.
But you said, as far as how to interpret the Scripture, you made it sound like there was, like you said, there were like rules of how to interpret thing that Christian history has, but these are not rules that people agree on. It's only the rules of your camp, which is a small part of it. I mean, it's like, if you had three main camps there, you're just one third of them. I mean, the numbers aren't equal. I don't know which most are, but I'm just saying that I don't know how you can say that there's rules of interpretation when there are no rules of interpretation, because every group can call the other one heretics, basically.
Yeah, people can say lots of things, but that doesn't reflect the reality of how the scholarship is done. Mm-hmm. As I've interacted with theologians and studied and talked about this, is there are generally accepted rules. And so I would say, when you're looking at this old earth, young earth, evolutionary creationism spectrum, it's not that the 24-hour day is an improper interpretation of Scripture, or that that's an invalid way of interpreting Scripture. I think there's some ambiguity as to what the length, what that time scale is. The problem comes is when the young earth creationists decide to say that this is the only way to interpret it. Well, that's no longer consistent with biblical theologians who do hold Scripture in high regard and who apply these techniques. So nobody's saying that the young earth interpretation is out of bounds. The question is, does it align with what God's revealed through Scripture as well as what he's revealed through creation? And I think it fails on that second test.
Okay, well, thanks for calling in. We're out of time on this show. We're going to tape another show. Appreciate your time and volunteering to do this.
Well, thanks. I've enjoyed the conversation.
Yeah, me too. Okay, thanks. Bye.